السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، ولا عدوان إلا على الظالمين، ولا عاقبة للمتقين. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على عبدك ورسولك محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. Dear brothers and sisters, I want to start off with a reflection on a very powerful ayah in the Quran. And I know it departs a little bit from the topic, but I hope that you'll be able to connect the dots as we go along. Where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about one of the most extraordinary young men that has ever walked the face of the earth. In fact, this deen that we follow is his deen. This way that we follow is his path. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to follow his way, فَاتَّبِعْهُ. And that is Ibrahim alayhi salam, the one who Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw in the highest heaven whenever he traveled on the night of al-Isra wal-Mi'raj, and the one whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, هُوَ اجْتَبَاكُمْ وَسَمَّاكُمْ وَالْمُسْلِمِينَ, that he chose you and named you Muslims. Some of the scholars said that Ibrahim alayhi salam was the one who actually did the naming of calling us Muslims, and some said Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did. But surely, you know, a man that accomplished amazing things, who till today in every major rukun of this deen, we commemorate his sacrifice, we commemorate his effort in the salah, when we do as-salah Ibrahimiyya, Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ala Ali Muhammad, kama sallaita ala Ibrahim wa ala Ali Ibrahim. Hajj is about following the pillars, or following the acts, the manasik that Ibrahim alayhi salam was taught by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam reinforced. And in particular, the ayah that I want to look at, that I want you to reflect upon for a moment. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about Ibrahim alayhi salam, إِنَّ إِبْرَاهِيمَ كَانَ أُمَّةً. Ibrahim alayhi salam was an ummah by himself. He was an entire nation. He was a ummah. And a lot, you know, when you read the tafsir of this ayah, it's very interesting because the scholars struggled with this concept. First and foremost, the linguistic meaning of the word ummah. And if we come to the conclusion that ummah represents a community, represents a nation, then what does it mean in regards to Ibrahim alayhi salam? So some of the scholars, they said that what it means is that Ibrahim alayhi salam was a ummah, kana ummah, because all of the arguments that Ibrahim alayhi salam put forth to his people throughout his entire youth until he got married. So a good portion of his life, all of the debating that Ibrahim alayhi salam did, Ibn Kathir calls him Afsah al-Anbiya, the most eloquent of the prophets. Everything that he put forward, we read his arguments in the Quran, and you know what? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that by the time Ibrahim alayhi salam was finished with his people, with all of those arguments, and his father instigated the murder of Ibrahim alayhi salam, and he was thrown into the fire, stripped naked in front of the people, humiliated. And then he left that fire, and he left his people. And he said, Rabbi habli min as-salihin, O Allah, grant me from the righteous, that not a single person from his people believed in him, except for his wife and his cousin Lut alayhi salam, who was in another locality anyway. Can you imagine that? The arguments that he put forth to his people were extraordinary arguments. And he strove like no other human being could strive. But with all of that, nobody believed in him. So in that regard, for a while, Ibrahim alayhi salam really did represent the ummah. But it means something much more powerful than that. As the majority of the mufassirin have pointed out, which I find phenomenal, that they say that what Ibrahim alayhi salam was able to accomplish, the good that Ibrahim alayhi salam put forth, an entire nation could not put forth. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called him an ummah. Everything about him was invested towards the da'wah, was invested towards spreading this message. Emotionally, he invested himself into this message. He committed himself to the cause. You know how hurtful it was for him to hear those words from his father? He loved his father. If he didn't love his father, he wouldn't have been making dua for him the entire time until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbade him from doing so. He loved his father. And to have your father reject you that way, to have your people reject you that way, he emotionally invested himself so much into this da'wah, physically invested himself to the point that again, he was going to be killed had Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not saved him and made the fire bardan wa salama, cool and peaceful upon him. And his and we all know, I mean, any, you know, subhanAllah, that statement, sticks and stones may break my bones, but words will never hurt. We all know that's a big lie. Emotional hurt, emotional abuse is much more severe than physical abuse, right? And that's why, you know, when we were growing up, many of you might have this, the same understanding that, you know what, growing up, if you did something bad, you really wanted your parents to just hit you, just get it over with. But the worst moments were when your dad would put you in the corner of your mom and say, I'm disappointed in you. You really let me down. I can't, you know, I don't even know what to make out of this. It's like, Dad, could you just smack me across the face and just get it over with? You know, there's the belt. You know? This is much more painful than that, right? Because that emotionally hurts you. You know, that really, it beats you down on the inside. And Ibrahim alayhi salam was beat down inside out for this cause. And you know what's amazing? When he leaves Haran to Egypt, he continues the da'wah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about the person who, the king, the oppressive king, who says to Ibrahim alayhi salam, when Ibrahim alayhi salam says, Rabbi alladhi yuhyi wa yumeet, my Lord is the one when who gives life and gives death. And Nimrud says, Ana uhyi wa umeet, I give life and I give death. How do I give life and I give death? Nimrud said, well, here's a guy that was going to be killed, and I'm going to let him go. And here's a guy that's innocent, I'm going to kill him. See, I give life and I give death too. Qala Ibrahim, فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْتِي بِالشَّمْسِ مِنَ الْمَشْرِقِ فَأْتِي بِهَا مِنَ الْمَغْرِبِ. He said, okay, Allah brings the sun from the east, bring it from the west. فَبُهِتَ الَّذِي كَفَرْ. Right? The disbeliever was baffled. He didn't know what to say. So Ibrahim alayhi salam continued his da'wah from Haran to Masr to Iraq. Everywhere he went, he was completely, entirely invested in the da'wah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls him by himself a ummah, an entire nation. And from Ibrahim alayhi salam, all of the umam would come out just by himself. And one of the proofs of that is that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam referred to one of his sahaba in the same way. And that sahabi was Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Inna Abdullah ibn Mas'ud ummah. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud by himself is an ummah. Now let's study Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiyallahu anhu to understand that for a minute. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiyallahu ta'ala anhu was a young man in the time of when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam received the message. He has no lineage. He doesn't, you know, subhanallah, no one to take care of him, no tribe. He's one of the low people of society. He's a young shepherd that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam walked by with Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu one day, and he was in charge of some sheep, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, can we have something to drink? Can we have some milk to drink? And Abdullah ibn Mas'ud said, no, because I am a ghulam mu'taman. I was trusted with this flock. I can't give you anything. So the Prophet ﷺ said, i'tina bishad la labana fi. Bring us a sheep then, a goat that has nothing, no milk, that doesn't produce milk. And Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu saw the Prophet ﷺ say, Bismillah, put his hands on the udders, and the milk came out. Gave a drink to Abu Bakr, drank from it, gave a drink to Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam praised the trait, the attribute of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, which was his trustworthiness. This same Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu goes and accepts Islam, one of the first to accept Islam. Goes out from the very start, he's the first person to recite Quran publicly. Despite having no protection, no one to take care of him, he doesn't care. He believes so wholeheartedly in this message that he goes out and he starts reciting Surah Al-Rahman. And the people are listening to him and they're saying, what is that? And then they realize this is from the poetry of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as they called it. And they jumped on him and they beat him unconscious, broke his collarbones. And when Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu woke up from that beating, that throbbing, they said to Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu, why did you do that? You know, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam didn't tell you to go recite publicly. We're not yet in that stage of public da'wah. Why did you do that? And he said, wallahi, I want to do the same thing today. I want to go back and make them listen to the Quran and they can beat me up again. I don't care. He didn't care. And he is the one who, when the public da'wah started officially with the Islam of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he is the one that called the Islam of Umar victory, izzah, honor for the deen. Why? Because now he could go out and give da'wah freely without having to worry about any of that stuff. That's Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Ibn Mas'ud is the same one who would climb on the chest of Abu Jahl in Badr. And Abu Jahl would look at him and would say, لَقَدْ ارْتَقَيْتَ مُرْتَقًا صَعْبًا يَا رُوَيْعَ الْغَنَبِ. You have climbed a difficult mountain, O shepherd of sheep. Who do you think you are? Do you know who I am? Look how arrogant Abu Jahl is. He's a huge human being. And Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu stands on top of him. And he says to Ibn Mas'ud, لِمَنَ الْغَلَبَ. By the way, who's winning the battle? He's about to die. Who's winning the battle? And Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu tells him, الْغَلَبَ لِلَّهِ وَلِرَسُولِ اللَّهِ يَا عَدُوَ اللَّهِ. Victory is for Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who enemy of Allah. And Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu would take the life of the Fir'aun of this ummah. Now Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu, what makes him so amazing is that Ibn Mas'ud was a dwarf physically. Physically speaking, he had a deformity. He was short, and some of the Sahaba at one point even made fun of him. As the incident is narrated, that Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu was climbing the Araq tree to get the siwak, and a wind blew him into that tree and his legs were exposed, and the Sahaba laughed at him. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, what are you laughing at? They said, Ya Rasulullah, look at his legs are small. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu was a short human being. As you know, it's said that the sitting person would be at eye level with him when he was standing. He was a short human being. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, لَهُمَا أَثْقَلُ فِي الْمِيزَانِ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ مِنْ أُحُدْ. Those two legs that you're laughing at are more heavy on the scales of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the Day of Judgment than the mountain of Uhud. Why? The man gave everything for Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He was an ummah by himself. He's a nation. He taught this ummah the Quran. You know, Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu, when Iraq was giving Umar a hard time, Umar radiallahu anhu said, look, I'm going to send you a guy that if you give him a hard time, that means for sure that you are at fault, because there's no way that he's going to do anything wrong. He sent them Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu. He said, it pains me to send him to you. But he sent him to Iraq because he said, you know, maybe that will fix the situation over there. And when Umar radiallahu anhu, the next time he saw a group of people coming from Iraq, and he started to ask them questions, everything that they answered with was Quran. Where are you going to? Al-Bayt al-Atiq, the Kaaba. Where are you coming from? Fajjin Amiq, a dark valley. He's just asking them questions, they're answering with Quran. And he says, Afikum Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. You have Abdullah ibn Mas'ud amongst you, don't you? Yeah. He taught the ummah the Quran. His entire life was invested towards the deen. And so what Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu accomplishes, an entire nation doesn't accomplish. And that's why Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says about Abi Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, the greatest human being who ever walked the face of the earth, who was not a prophet. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, لَوْ وُزِنَتْ إِيمَانُ أَبِي بَكْرِ. If you took the iman of Abu Bakr and put it on a scale and put the rest of the ummah, all of the iman, all of the faith, you imagine all of the Umars and Uthmans and all the Sahaba, all the Tabi'een, the Hasan al-Basris, the Abdullah ibn al-Mubaraks, the Malik ibn Dinars, the Ibn Taymiyyahs, the Al-Ghazaris, the Dhahab, you put all of those people on one side and you put Abu Bakr on the other side, لَرَجَحَتْ إِمَانُ أَبِي بَكْرٍ. Abu Bakr's iman was heavier than all of their iman. All of us sitting here today, one man outdoes billions in his iman. Why? Because everything about Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. He invested himself physically, emotionally, spiritually, mentally. He gave it his all, blood, sweat, and tears. It was all for the ummah. It was all for La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. The point that I'm trying to make, dear brothers and sisters, is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us certain capabilities, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has certain expectations of us. And the expectations that Allah has of us is different than the expectations that people have set for us. Many of you, your parents would be satisfied if you just, you know, prayed on time, were nice to them, fasted, attended halaqas here and there. They'd be happy. They'd say, alhamdulillah, you know, I'm good. You became the trophy hafiz kid and didn't completely, you know, humiliate them. Alhamdulillah, great. You know, my kid's doing all right. Or, you know what, maybe a little bit more. You know, get involved with YM or Mass Youth or whatever it may be and really put your heart into it. That's good enough. Okay, alhamdulillah, good. You know, that's all a parent could ask for. But Allah has other expectations for you. Look, the father of Ibrahim alayhi salam didn't want Ibrahim alayhi salam to be a prophet. He didn't have expectations for him, but Allah had expectations of him. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu had no parents to set expectations for him. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had expectations for him. I can't see that. It says 5 minutes. Okay. You know, the point is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sets expectations for you. And I always mention this example because I find it so significant. You look at what some individuals have been able to accomplish, and you know what? You go to almost any community in the United States today, and if that community is awesome, if you study it enough, you can trace it down to one person. You can track down one or two or three individuals who are doing everything, right? And that's a problem because they might get burned out. More likely than not, they'll eventually get burned out. But it's usually on the back of one person. You go to some communities, you see, mashallah, you know, in terms of youth activities, social activities, Quran, hadith, whatever it may be, interfaith, social work, social justice, like that community is doing an awesome job. And then you find out it's just one, they just have an incredible imam, or they have an incredible director, or they have an incredible, you know, brother or sister that's behind the scenes organizing all this stuff. It almost always happens when you go and you study communities. Now, the reason why the Sahaba accomplished so much is because they were all awesome. Right? They all had that drive. They had that motivation. But subhanAllah, in our day and age, it's just the fact that it's very few. You know? There is many from the earlier generations, وَقَلِيلٌ مِنَ الْآخِرِينَ, just a few from the later generations that take on that task, that really put their hearts and dedicate themselves to this message. And I always use the example of Sheikh Ahmed Didat, rahimahullah ta'ala. What that man accomplished by himself, entire umam would not accomplish in our day and age. In fact, what he accomplished with his eyes when he was paralyzed, and he was just writing letters with the last few years of his life with his eyes, debating with people, sending letters to different people, debating with his Christian nurses, and one of his Christian nurses accepting Islam because he used his eyes to give her da'wah. We don't even do that with our full capability, with our entire bodies, right? But when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts that inspiration inside of you, you dedicate yourself. And so the question is, with these last few minutes, I really didn't, that was supposed to just be the introduction to the talk. But the question is that I have for you, and then I'll let you think about it. How much of your free time goes towards La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah? When you're sitting alone, how many of your thoughts are occupied by the situation of the ummah, and you're standing in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Serious things, important things. When you are sad, what is it that usually gets you sad and gets you down? Right? Is it that your football team lost the game? Is it that your favorite celebrity, your favorite athlete broke up with their girlfriend or broke up with their boyfriend? Or, you know, what is it that gets you down? Is it that you get a flat tire or you dropped your phone and you broke your phone and, you know, you don't have internet for today? What is it that gets you down, that actually burdens you, that actually weighs heavy on your heart and on your thoughts? What is it that keeps you up at night when you're not able to sleep? Is it that somebody threw a really nasty comment at you on Facebook? Do you realize how shallow of a generation we are sometimes? Right? What keeps you up at night? Seriously. That somebody made a comment that you didn't like, somebody said something to you, and I'm going to show them. What meaningful things keep us up at night and occupy our thoughts? And when I get tired and I consume my body and I consume my health and my time, the greatest two blessings that are neglected, as the Prophet ﷺ said. You know, what is it being used for? When I'm tired, physically, emotionally, exhausted, what is it being used for? And if it's for something other than the cause that's going to determine your fate and whether or not you will be in paradise or hellfire, wal-iyadu billah, then there's a big problem there, because that makes you a neglectful person. And it makes me a neglectful person. It makes us a people of heedlessness and ghafla. And so I ask that question, and I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive me for the lengthy introduction, and if this talk wasn't more practical, but I hope throughout the conference, inshallah ta'ala, there will be more practicality in the talks, and this was hopefully just an introduction to the conference. Inna Ibrahima kana umma. Ibrahim alayhi salam was an ummah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us the most glorious ummah, to make us people who live up to the job description of al-amr bil ma'ruf wa nahi anil munkar, enjoining good and forbidding evil. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us for our shortcomings. Allahumma ameen. Jazakumullahu khayran. Aqulu qawli hadha wa astaghfirullahi wa lakum. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.